Welcome to part 6 of my Unitail crash course. This episode is the conclusion of the wave-making trilogy. But there will be an extra episode where we are going to recreate one attack from Undertail in Unitail. I have already decided which one, but it will be a surprise. Anyways, the focus this time will be on creating somewhat more advanced attack patterns using some simple math. Yes, you've heard me correctly. This episode will focus on quick maths. But don't worry. I'll do my best to make the learning experience as fun as possible. Anyways, like, subscribe and all that cool stuff. If you need help, ask the Unitail subreddit and Discord. Speaking of which, be sure to join my own Discord. Link is in the description. Have fun learning! Let's start with something simple. Changing the length of a wave. The wave timer variable in the encounter script determines how many seconds a wave lasts. The default length of a wave is 4 seconds. Changing it where it's declared will change the length of all waves. To change the length of a specific wave, go to Enemy Dialogue Ending. By default, a wave is selected from a list of possible attacks here. After this line, check if the first index in the next wave's array is the name of a random wave and set the wave timer to something different. You can add more checks for other waves if you want. There is another way to set the wave timer from the wave script, but that's a topic for another video. Next, let's change the arena size for a wave. Another variable in the encounter script, arena size, keeps track of the arena's width and height in pixels. Just like with the wave timer, change it in the if statement we just created to change it for that specific wave. Add an else statement with default values, otherwise attacks that aren't checked for might have an unfitting arena size or wavelength. Aside from changing the location of a bullet, you can also rotate and scale it, which is what we'll be doing next. Rotation and scale are set using the bullet sprite, which you can access using bullet.sprite. The rotation of a sprite is in degrees and is clamped between 0 and 360, so 365 becomes 5, for instance. The rotation is counterclockwise and happens around the pivot point, which is at the center of the bullet by default. You can change the pivot by using the function setPivot. xPivot controls the horizontal location and yPivot controls the vertical location. A pivot of 0,0 is in the bottom left corner and 1,1 is in the top right corner of the bullet. Values below 0 and above 1 are also accepted. Scale determines how large your bullet will be. By default, the scale is 1,1. It is set using the setScale function. xScale controls the horizontal, yScale the vertical scale. The scaling also happens around the pivot. The last concept I will introduce in this video is the concept of bullet variables. Each bullet can store one or multiple variables which can be accessed later for various purposes. You can set a bullet variable using this syntax. To access it and assign it to a variable for further use, you can use this very similar syntax. All variables are case sensitive, so test isn't the same as test or test. Let's put what we've learned to good use. The first thing we'll code are bullets that target the player. The wave will look like this. For all waves in this tutorial, I will use the code we wrote last time as a basis to start from. To get the bullets to target the player, we need two bullet variables, valx and valy. The val stands for velocity, or simply put, speed. The variables determine how fast the bullets move on the x and y axis. If we combine different positive and negative values, we can make the bullets move in any direction that we want. To target the player, we need the difference between the player and the bullet on both axes. Difference means subtraction, so subtract the player's x value from the bullet's x value and do the same with the y values. Name the results something like x difference and y difference and set them as val x and val y respectively. Divide them by something like 100 so the bullets fly at an acceptable speed. Then move a bullet using its own variables instead of a simple number by accessing the variables like I've explained. This works fine, however the bullets move faster or slower depending on the distance to the player when they spawn. If we want them to move at the same speed no matter the distance, we need to use some vector algebra. A vector sporty at school, cheer up, because they're actually going to be useful now. Let's imagine a bullet's flight path as an arrow. This is a common visual representation for a vector, which is a quantity that has a direction and a length. We will normalize this vector, which means that its direction remains unchanged, but its length will become 1. In this case, the length equals the speed, so all bullets will be equally fast. To normalize a 2D vector, you first need its length. This is done by exponentiating both components, which means to multiply them with themselves and then using a square root. Lua has some built-in math functions which will come in handy here. Use math.pow for the exponentiation and math.squirt for the square root afterwards. Lastly, divide both x difference and y difference by the length. And there you go! All bullets move at the same speed, which is way too slow now, so you should multiply the difference variables by something like 2. To delay the targeting and give the player some time to dodge, check if a bullet is at least a certain number of frames old before moving it. To get a bullet's age, store the frame timer when the bullet is spawned as a new bullet variable called frame underscore spawned. Once the bullet is supposed to be moved, create a new variable called bullet age and subtract the frame timer from the bullet variable frame underscore spawned. This calculates how many frames the bullet has existed already. If bullet age is bigger than, say, 45, move the bullet. And there you have it, a cool wave that actually provides a decent challenge. Let's move on to something random. Literally. We will spawn bullets in random locations now. Getting random numbers requires another math function called math.random. It takes two arguments, min and max, and returns an integer between them. We want the bullets to spawn outside of the arena, or else they might spawn where the soul is, which isn't fair. There are different ways to ensure all bullets spawn outside the arena, so there might be a better way, but I'm using an easy to understand one. First, set a random x value between 0 and the arena's width divided by 2 plus 40. If the x value is smaller than arena.width divided by 2 plus 20, set a y value above the arena. Otherwise, set a random y value like we did with the x value, but using the arena's height. This will spawn bullets to the top right of the arena. To spawn them on all sides, get a random value between 0 and 3. If it's 0, do nothing. If it's 1, invert the x value by writing rand x equals minus rand x. If it's 2, invert the y value, and if it's 3, invert both. Done! You can combine this code with the player targeting code to recreate the flame attack from my own mod. It's pretty cool, by the way. To spawn bullets at random intervals, we need to change our approach of timing bullet spawns. Instead of using a frame timer which counts up, we use a spawn delay variable which counts down. Set it to 0 at the start. Check if it is 0 using an if statement and put your bullet spawn code in there. Then set the spawn delay variable using a random value between something like 15 and 45. Now bullets will spawn at random intervals. Be careful when using randomness in your waves. It can add variety to a wave, but it can also create unpredictable and thus unfair attacks, so be considerate. And that's it for the basics of wave making. This was quite a journey and a challenge, but I feel like I've already learned a lot from it. I learned about video editing, teaching, coding, and math all while making this series. I hope you look forward to the last episode about waves. Good news, the episodes after that won't be nearly as long or as complicated as the wave tutorial, so progress should be faster. I can't wait to talk about sprites, animation, music, and much more. Creator out.